Today, we will really see what BKT position is, and then I will illustrate it with experiments performed either with photons or with atoms. Okay, so let me remind you where we are now. The problem that we studied initially was a problem inspired by pairs but transposed to Bose-Einstein condensation, which was what happens to a macroscopic quantum fluid when you put it in two dimensions, where actually, because of the Mermin-Wagner-Hohenberg theorem, there is no long-range order in a uniform system, infinite uniform, so there is no BEC, but there is still, this is what I would like to show today, still the room for a superfluid transition. And yesterday, we confirmed the result of Mermin-Wagner by calculating the one-body correction function, G1, which is you take the one-body density operator, the density matrix, and you took its matrix element between R, a point R, and a point R prime, and when you let R minus R prime tend to infinity, you find that this function in 2D must always tend to zero when R minus R prime tends to infinity, if the temperature is non-zero. And this is to be contrasted with the 3D case, where when you have a Bose condensate, then when R minus R prime tends to infinity, this function tends to a non-zero value, which is essentially giving you the condensed fraction. However, we also obtained yesterday very different behaviors. They were both compatible with Mermin-Wagner, but they were very different, whether the gas was ideal or interacting. I remind you this result. For the ideal gas, we found that the G1 was always decreasing in an exponential way, whereas if we take an interacting gas, and if I describe it by a classical field, psi of R and T, we spend a lot of time justifying this classical field approach. If you neglect the density fluctuation for this classical field, so you take only into account phase fluctuation, and furthermore, you assume that they are smooth, so I was neglecting vortices at that time, I was considering only phonons, then we found that for the interacting gas, G1 was decreasing in a much smoother way than this exponential. It was decreasing only algebraically, 1 over R to the power alpha, where alpha is related to the phase space density, rho lambda square, rho is the density, lambda T is the thermal wavelength. Let me write it again because it's a quantity which I use quite often. So lambda T, square root of 2 pi, h bar over square root of m kbt. Rho is the density. And actually, what I told you in a heuristic way, that the density I should put here, rho, is not really the total density, but it's more a superfluid density following some renormalization argument that I didn't develop, but which are present in the literature. And so just as an illustration, here for a phase space density of 10, I have plotted the G1 function. So again, it has to tend to zero at infinity in all cases because of Mermin-Wagner theorem. But for the ideal gas, it tends to zero fast. This is this exponential law. Whereas for the interacting gas, it tends to zero very slowly, like this, because this is this algebraic decay with an exponent, which is alpha, which is very small. Okay, so now I would like to go one step further and take into account more physics of this classical gas. And by saying more physics, I mean taking into account vortices. And I already gave you a teaser yesterday of why vortices might be important. And I show this slide again. I showed it exactly in the same way yesterday. That is, I was telling you that if you have a gas with a smooth phase variation in the absence of vortices, then the simple fact of being able to add one vortex between two points A and B will change dramatically the phase relation between A and B, because a vortex itself corresponds to a 2 pi phase winding around it. So if I take two opposite sides from the vortex, I have a pi difference. And therefore, depending on whether I have no vortex between A and B or a vortex between A and B, the phase will fluctuate between phi and phi plus pi. So if I allow vortices to be present in my system, then this will kill immediately the phase relation between those two points, A and B. So the question is, can vortices be present in the system? What is the condition for them to be there? And later, we'll see whether we can detect them experimentally. So this is the goal of this lecture. We have seen that the freezing of density fluctuation is effective only at low temperature in the absence of vortices. So at a larger temperature, you expect that if KT is very large compared to the interaction strength, so you should recover the ideal case, no interaction, so you should recover an exponential decay. How does this occur? Is it a crossover or is it a unconventional phase transition. The answer is a second. It is an unconventional phase transition, and this is this BKT transition. And as I already said, the elementary bricks of this transition are the vortices, that is zero of the special density with a phase winding of plus or minus 2 pi around this zero. Actually, it could be n times 2 pi. I could have a doubly charged vortex or triply charged vortex, but these play a very little role. If you have a doubly charged vortex, you can view it simply as two vortices which charge plus 2 pi on the top of each other, and then they can move with respect to each other. So it's enough to restrict to simple vortices, plus or minus 2 pi. OK, so this is the outline of the lecture. First, I would like to spend some time reviewing the BKT transition. Then, the first question we'll try to answer is, can a single vortex exist in an infinite 2D Bose fluid? Then I would like to review some experimental consequences for atomic, molecular, and optical physics, critical points, superfluidity, quasi-long-range order. And then, if I have time, I would like to discuss a bit the notion of a scale invariance and quantum anomalies. So we will make a break, and the break will be either here or somewhere in the middle of two, in 1 hour from now or in 50 minutes from now. OK, so let me start with this first question. Can a single vortex exist in an infinite 2D Bose fluid? And I would like, again, to start with something I already announced yesterday, which is, how can a vortex appear in such a system? I have my classical field, psi of r, which depends on time because of thermal fluctuation. I have my classical field, and I told you yesterday, a vortex is a zero of this classical field, and the classical field is complex. So to get a zero of the classical field, I need to have the real part of the field to be zero and the imaginary part to be zero at the same place. Okay? And yesterday I told you this corresponds to a crossing of zeros of the real part and zeros of the imaginary part. So how can I have this? Let me start with a situation where I have no vortex. So I have my classical field psi of xy. The real part can be zero on a line like this. So let's say it will be positive here and negative here, and it's zero on this line. The imaginary part, so in red it is the real part, and in green the imaginary part. The imaginary part is the same, but the two lines do not cross. So I do not have any vortex in my system. At any place in this rectangle here, the modulus of psi is non-zero because there is no place where the real and imaginary cancel simultaneously. But now, because of the fluctuations, these lines are going to move because of the thermal fluctuation. These lines are going to move. They may touch each other, and they may then cross like this. Okay, you just have to think of this field fluctuating in time, and you may get that. When you get that, this is exactly the situation I considered yesterday. This corresponds to two zeros of the classical field. Okay, the classical field is zero here because both real and imaginary are zero, and same thing here. Here, actually, it's a double zero. You see this in the intermediate case where the two lines are just tangent. It's a double zero. It's when these two points merge to the same place. What I would like to claim is that this is a vortex pair. These two zeros are two vortices. I would like to claim that this is a vortex pair, that is, that their circulation are opposite. That is, they are rotating either like this or like that. And this is really easy to show. You just have to consider what happens when you have two zeros nearby like this. So let me say that the real part is positive here, negative, positive. The imaginary part is negative, positive. So it's a kind of generalization of the graph I showed you yesterday. And then when you look at these two zeros that I get on when following, say, the line where the imaginary of psi is zero, then you just have to follow the phase, say, here both real part and imaginary part are positive and so on. So I remind you, we studied this yesterday. This corresponds to a plus pi phase winding. If you do exactly the same exercise for this vortex here, following again how the phase vary, you find out immediately, I mean, just there is no calculation to do. You just have to look how where is the point on the trigonometric circle. You find out that the phase of this one is opposite to that one, the phase winding. So this fluctuation that I was showing on the previous graph here, this fluctuation of the field creates a pair of vortices of opposite circulation. And I can, of course, play the movie back. And this will correspond to annihilation of this pair of vortices. Okay, so this dynamical view, you should view this classical field as a dynamical object where you have constantly creation and annihilation of pairs of vortices. And this occurs by a big density fluctuation where you have a big hole in the density where you have a zero, but a zero with no phase winding here. This zero can be viewed as a plus vortex and a minus vortex, plus 2 pi and minus 2 pi on top of each other. Then they separate. This is what you have here. And then they may come back, annihilate, and disappear. Okay, it's a bit like a plasma in which you would have some electrons and positrons, and constantly the electron and positron would annihilate and form again, and so on. So this is what happens in this situation. Okay, so now that this is said, let's try to see whether I can, if I take a big sample, whether I can have a single vortex in my system. Let's say that a pair has been created. One of the vortices went to the edge of my sample. Can I get a single vortex with a charge plus 2 pi, for example, in the middle of my sample? So for that, I have to calculate the energy associated to a single vortex. And this is not a difficult calculation. A single vortex, let's put it in R equals 0, and I will take a sample which will be a disk. This will make the calculation simple. So my vortex, I take simply a square root for psi of R, I have the square root of the density times phase theta of R, which I take equal to phi. Phi is the polar angle, so in this way, I have indeed a 2 pi phase winding here. The velocity field, I told it several times now, is just the gradient of the phase within the coefficient h bar over m. So when you calculate the gradient of theta given by that, you get h bar over mr u phi, where u phi is the unit vector. So the velocity field of a vortex is orthoradial. And this velocity field decreases like 1 over r when you get away from the center. This is completely the opposite of rigid body rotation. Rigid body rotation, if I take a big object and rotate it like this, the velocity field increases with r. The further away you are from center, the larger your velocity. The velocity field of a vortex is just the opposite. The velocity diverges when you approach the center and gets smaller and smaller when you get away from the center. But this is necessary if you want the circulation of your velocity to be quantized. If you want the integral of the velocity to be the same on a small circle and a large circle, you need this 1 over r dependence. There is no mystery here. Okay, so one thing I should make clear also is the density profile of this vortex, the density rho of r. So this you can calculate. You can calculate the density profile, which provides you with the minimum energy, knowing that you need this phase winding. So the density has to be zero at the center. Otherwise, because of this 1 over r divergence of the velocity, you would get an infinite kinetic energy. So you need a zero density at the center. And the size typically of the vortex core, the size where the density is significantly different from the bulk density here, is the so-called healing length. And when you minimize the energy of the system, you find that the healing length is just 1 over square root of g tilde. G tilde, again, is this dimensionless parameter characterizing the interaction in the gas, times the density rho, or I should put here actually, to be more correct, the superfluid density rho s, because what I'm describing by this classical field is really this superfluid density. Okay, so the real profile is known. Pitayevsky was the first one to derive that. This is the reason for which he introduced the so-called Gross-Pitayevsky equation in the 60s. For us, we will model it by a step function. We will say that the density is constant here and zero on a size xi. This will make the calculation easier and doesn't change much the result. So what is the energy of a vortex? Let's calculate that to see what is the probability for a vortex to appear. So there are two type of energies in my system, kinetic energy and interaction energy. And the dominant term, as you will see, is the kinetic energy. So let's calculate that. So the kinetic energy is 1 half of m, the density rho times v square, integrated over the whole sample. Again, I take a disk of radius r to make calculation simple. I remind you that the velocity is 1 over r, so v square will be 1 over r square. Rho of r, I will take it constant outside of the vortex core. Then I have this d2r, which is 2 pi r dr, so I'm left with 1 over r, again, a logarithm. The 2D world is the world of logarithm. You get logs everywhere. So this is another example of a log which appears. So I get a log, and the bounds of my integral are, the lower bound is xi, this healing length, the size of the vortex core. I don't want to, I said that the density is zero if I take little r smaller than little xi. And then the upper bound is simply the size of the sample, capital R. So I get something which is, as a prefactor, pi h-bar squared, the density rho divided by the mass, times log of r over psi. And the important thing here is that the size of the system enters into the energy of a single object. My object is a vortex. It's a microscopic object. But its energy depends macroscopically of the size of the system. It's in a log, of course, but still, it depends on the size of the object. So if I take a bigger and bigger disk, even if I have a single vortex, I will get an energy which will diverge. Okay? So this is the key element for understanding BKT physics. Now you can calculate the interaction energy, which is the second component. This is the energy you must pay to create a hole of size xi in the fluid. And this one does not diverge. So I'm not doing the calculation here, but I think you have everything to do it with the result on the previous slides. It's just simply h-bar squared rho over m. So this is actually the prefactor, which is here, but it doesn't have the log, which is diverging. So it's much smaller than the kinetic energy. And we will work now with this kinetic energy. OK, so now let's ask the following question. If I take a disk like this, is the existence of an isolated vortex likely? So I'm doing here a very simple analysis. One can do something much more sophisticated with a renormalization group. But at this stage, this simple analysis will already tell us a lot. And actually, you will find this analysis in the initial paper by Kosterlitz and Thaules. So I have to put a vortex. I ask myself, let's look at what happens if I put the vortex somewhere in the disk here. So I have many places where to put the vortex. The vortex has a size xi or 2 xi. I wanted to put it in a disk of radius r. So the number of independent ways to put the vortex in this box is the area of the box divided by the area of a vortex core. So it's typically r squared over xi squared. There may be a prefactor here, but it's not relevant for what we want to say. And now, once I have picked up a particular box, the probability to have a vortex in this box is just the Boltzmann factor, the exponential of the kinetic energy I just derived before, the one varying with the log, divided by kbt. And so now, if I take this kinetic energy I calculated before and put it in this exponential here, so a kinetic divided by kbt is just this log that I found before, log of r over psi. I had this pi h-bar squared rho over m as a prefactor, and now I'm dividing everything by kbt. And you see, again, appearing h-bar squared over m kbt, which is nothing but the W wavelength, thermal wavelength, which is written on the board. So this is nothing. All this here is nothing that rho times lambda squared, again. So what I see appearing here is the phase space density, the quantity that I've been using a lot, actually with a factor 2, because there is a 2 pi here, and I have only 1 pi here. So it's d over 2. Phase space density divided times log of r over xi. And so the probability p to be in a given box is this exponential of a log. And the exponential of a log is, of course, the function itself, r over xi, or xi over r, to the power d over 2. OK, so the total probability for a vortex to appear, yes? What about the conservation of angular momentum? So I assume here that when I form my vortex pair, I have no problem with angular momentum. I have plus h-bar and one minus h-bar. And as long as the vortices are present, it's OK. And then if I say I get rid of one of the two members of the pair, when it touches the edge, it means that the edges are sufficiently rough to accommodate for the angular momentum. It's true that in a perfectly isolated object, system with perfect cylindrical symmetry of the confining potential, in principle, angular momentum would be conserved, and then I cannot get a single vortex out of nothing because it would violate the angular momentum conservation. Thanks for the question. But here I assume that I have some walls to first create a pair and then get rid of one, and the walls will absorb the angular momentum, okay? Which is the case in a liquid helium experiment, for example, where you have rough walls. Okay, so the total probability here is just the product of a single probability to be in one of these boxes times the number of boxes. So I have W here times little p. And the beauty of the thing, which is the thing that really Kosterlitz and Thaules understood, is that this W and this little p vary exactly in the same way. They are both functions of xi over r. One is xi over r to the power minus 2. It was r squared over xi squared, so it's xi over r to the power minus 2. And the probability little p is psi over r to the power d over 2. So you have, you end up with the total probability to have a vortex appearing in your disk, irrespective of the position, which is psi over r to the power of an exponent which contains an energetic term, this is the d over 2 we just calculated, and another term, minus 2, which can be viewed as an entropic term, entropic in the sense that it is simply the number of possibilities w to put the vortex in the sample. Okay, and the question now is, as usual when you are doing thermodynamics, is what is going to win? Is it the entropy or is it the energy? Okay, so let's look at that. So first of all, yes, it's better to be correct and to say that the total density is not really the relevant part. It's, what is relevant is a superfluid component. So again, this goes through some renormalization group analysis. So let's say that I replace by hand everywhere rho by a superfluid density rho s, phase space density d by ds. So ds is simply rho s times lambda square. And so the probability that I had before, minus 2 plus d over 2 is minus 2 plus d superfluid over 2. So there are two possibilities. If this exponent that I have here is positive, minus 2 plus ds over 2 positive, which means that the superfluid density ds is larger than 4, then it means that the energy wins against the entropy. Okay? It costs too much of energy to create a vortex. The gain in entropy is not enough to compensate for this cost of energy. Therefore, this if the exponent here is positive, the probability p will tend to zero when r tends to infinity. It means that there is no isolated vortex. The probability to get an isolated vortex is zero in the thermodynamic limit. I may have still pairs of vortices in my sample, but having an unbalanced number of positive and negative vortices will create a macroscopic current which will be too costly for me in respect of the gain I could have from the entropy. Okay, so then I will have no isolated vortices in this case. On the other hand, if the exponent here is negative, ds smaller than 4, then it means that the probability here is diverging when r tends to infinity. Of course, a diverging probability is meaningless. I mean, the probability should be smaller than 1. But it just means that a first vortex will appear, and then a second means that my pairs are going to break. Some vortices will go to the edge and annihilate, which will ensure momentum conservation. And then the rest of the gas will be full of vortices, and we will see the superfluidity will disappear. So we immediately see by this small, very simple argument that there is a magic number, so to speak, a number where a transition is going to occur, which is phase space density, superfluid phase space density equal 4. When I vary the temperature, I have a small phase space density proliferation of isolated vortices. Here I have large phase space density, no isolated vortices. And now I would like to claim that this small ds proliferation of isolated vortices correspond actually to having no superfluidity at all, so ds here will be strictly zero. And this is what I want to explain now. But before that, I can take any question that you may have on this simple calculation, which again is from directly inspired from Kosseritz and Thaulet's paper. No? Okay. So before looking at the breaking of superfluidity when ds is smaller than 4, when isolated vortices proliferate, let me look at the problem of vortex pairs, which is also very relevant. And by contrast to the isolated vortices, I would like to claim that vortex pairs will always be present in the system, at least if temperature is not zero, because of the mechanism I said before, creation of zero of density and apparition of pairs of zeros, positive and negative. So let's look at the velocity field of a vortex pair. So I take one vortex with a phase winding plus 2 pi, one vortex with phase winding minus 2 pi, and I look at this velocity field. So you can obtain it by some minimization of energy. You can also simply think of a magnetic analogy, actually. The velocity field that you get here is really the analog of the magnetic field that you would get if you take two parallel currents with opposite current, then you know that your magnetic field will be, if you take a single wire, the magnetic field, as you know, is like that, is orthoradial, and as a circulation which is just quantized because it's the value of the current flowing in the wire. And now if I take two wires, what I get is a dipolar magnetic field, and here is the same, I will get a dipolar velocity field. So this is the result that you get when you take these two vortices, and now the blue arrows are plotting the velocity field associated with these two vortices. So in the middle here, because the two vortex field rotate opposite way, halfway between these two vortices, the velocity field adds. But when I look far here, they compensate each other because the rotation are in opposite sense. It's a bit like a smoke ring, if you want. A smoke ring is also a vortex annulus. So here I take a smoke ring, but I cut it in a plane, and I look at what is the projection of a smoke ring in a plane, and this is exactly what you get. Rotation like that, rotation like that. And when you look at the structure of this dipolar velocity field at infinity, you find that the velocity decreases like 1 over r squared at infinity instead of the 1 over r that we got for a single vortex. So this will change dramatically the energy associated with this vortex pair. Indeed, the kinetic energy being 1 over, well, excuse me, the velocity being 1 over r squared means that when you take the integral of the kinetic energy, which is integral of v squared, I will get a 1 over r4, and the integral of 1 over r4 converges at infinity, when r tends to infinity. So there is no diverging kinetic energy now. So when you calculate the integral, I mean, this can be done actually completely analytically, you find the same prefactor as before for a single vortex, but now you have again a log, but the log does not contain anymore the size of the sample. The size of the sample is simply replaced by little l, which is the distance between the two members of the pairs. So if the two members are very close to each other, it doesn't cost much to create a vortex pair. A vortex pair will cost more and more when you try to take the two members apart, but when they are close to each other, it doesn't cost much. The interaction energy also costs something about that. I mean, this is the same. You have to create now two holes of psi in your sample, and so the interaction energy is twice the interaction energy you had for a single vortex, which was, as I said before, h bar squared rho s over m. And then the kinetic energy and the interaction energy are comparable if the two vertices have a distance which is comparable to the healing length, the size of a vortex core. And then you can play the same game as before, trying to see what is the probability for a vortex pair to appear in your sample. So again, I take this kinetic energy here. I take the Boltzmann weight, the exponential of the energy divided by kbt. And, well, I skip a little bit the details, but what you get here is that the probability to have a vortex pair with elongation L, a distance little l between the two members, is something which will be, again, the exponential of a log, so it will be psi over L to the power, the superfluid density. So, the larger L, the smaller this probability. But if the phase density is not too large compared to 1, and if I consider elongation L comparable to psi, this is a probability which is not so small, so I will have some vortex pairs in my system. Now, just to complete what I have said before for a single vortex, let's look at the average distance between the two members of the pair. Okay, I just tell you that it costs more and more energy when I take a pair and try to make the two partners far from each other. Yes? Excuse me, cannot hear you. Yes, there will be some entropic contribution too. Yes. Here I'm just calculating. For what I want to calculate, the entropic contribution will be both on numerator and denominator because I divide here. I normalize my probability distribution by this p by the denominator here. So I don't care about the entropic. But yes, if I wanted to calculate the probability to have one vortex pair in a big sample, there would be an entropic contribution exactly for the single vortex case, absolutely. So yes, so I was saying just to make the connection with what I got for a single vortex, let's try to see what happens when I take a pair and what is the average distance between the two members of a pair. So the probability to get a single a vortex pair with an elongation L is this psi over L to the power ds times, as your colleague said, some entropic factor, but which does not depend on L. Then when I calculate the average of RA minus RB, the vortex pair can have any orientation, so this is going to be zero, but I'm interested in the variance of RA minus RB, so the variance of the distance between the two members. So I have to calculate the integral of L squared P of L to pi L dl, again, the Jacobian in two dimensions. And not to have to calculate this entropic factor that should be here. I normalize this by PL to pi LDL. And then I am left with integral of something which will be L to the power 2 minus ds divided by the same typical integral, and I get something which is ds minus 2 divided by ds minus 4, just the integral of polynomial function. And what I get is that this average distance between the vortices, when the phase space density is large, I remind you there is no isolated vortex, and the average distance is very small on the order of psi, then when ds approaches 4 here, this denominator diverges, well, this denominator tends to zero, so the fraction diverges, and therefore the average distance gets larger and larger, and we recover the fact that for ds smaller than 4, free vortices can proliferate simply because now the pair are going to break. The entropic gain term is sufficiently to break the pairs and to favor the proliferation of single vortices. So I just showed that just to show you that indeed everything is consistent. When I look at single vortices, I find that they can only appear in this region. And when I look at pairs, I find that they exist everywhere, but the average distance in a pair diverges for d equal 4. So there is the picture is fully consistent. And again, this is all borrowed from the Kosolitz-Taules paper of 73. Question on that? Yes? Is it possible to look at the zeros as? Yes? So, I mean, when you study, for example, quantum turbulence, you are looking at those zeros. So all the physics in the zeros, indeed, this is the position of the. So now there are various techniques for looking at the zeros of a classical field, and there are some theorems. I'm not a specialist of those theorems. It's really mathematical physics at this stage, but I can give you some reference if you want. Yes, yes. Yes? Oh. This one? Yes, equals 3.
Equals 3.
Yes.
The numerator says something positive, the denominator something negative.
Yes, so it means that the calculation is meaningless. Yes,
it's meaningless.
It's meaningless. But actually what we will see is that DS equals 3 cannot exist. This is what I just want to claim afterwards. That is, either DS is larger than 4 or DS is 0.
That's why you didn't show the left-hand side.
Okay. Exactly. Yes, okay. Yes, exactly. Yes. So the question is, can I, because again, in order to obtain this yes, I said there is a renormalization group approach. I replaced rho by rho s, d by ds, saying I do some renormalization. So the question is it meaningful to speak of a phase space density, ds, which is smaller than 4? And the answer is no. The answer is no. As soon as, my claim is that as soon as a single vortex can exist in my infinite sample, then the superfluity will be broken, will be lost. I already told you that I will lose when I have some probability to have a finite, a single vortex in my system, a non-zero probability to have a single vortex in my system. I will lose quasi-long range order because it will completely scramble the phase. My claim is that it also ruins the superfluidity. And a simple way to see that is to come back to the definition of a superfluid. A superfluid is a system where you have permanent current, where you have metastable state, where you have a current flowing in your system and this current does not damp. So let's take an annular geometry like the one we can do with liquid helium or with cold atoms. Let's suppose that I have a permanent current here and I ask myself, is this current with some phase winding of my field, 2 pi n, is this current metastable? And it's easy to show that as soon as you have the possibility to have isolated vortices in your system, this current cannot be stable. Indeed, if I take a single vortex in my system, and if I just consider a possibility that this single vortex goes from this edge to that edge, this will correspond to changing the phase winding by one unit. When the vortex is inside here, I have some current which corresponds to this 2 pi n, and when my vortex goes from the center to the outer part of the ring, the phase winding is only n minus 1. So as soon as you have free vortices which can exist in your system, you cannot have any more permanent current because this permanent current will be crossed constantly by vortices with random signs, and this will rapidly damp your current to zero. So saying that you have a superfluid, saying that you have some non-zero superfluid density, means that you need to have, by definition, the possibility of having metastable current in your system, and this excludes the possibility of having free vortices. So, and this appears indeed in the randomization group approach, either ROS is larger than 4, and then everything is fine, or you start with a ROS which is smaller than 4, 3, for example, as in your example, and you process with the randomization group, and you find that ROS tends to 0 when you run the randomization approach. So the message that I want to say here is that ROS is either larger than 4, and then you have vortex pairs but no vortices, no single vortex, or ROS is smaller than 4, and then it has to be 0. Just by the way, a vortex pair is no problem. That is, if I have vortex pair in my system, a vortex pair can cross my annulus, and this will not change at all the value of n, because one vortex carries positive charge and the other one carries a negative charge, so the global charge is 0. So to summarize this part, we have this picture now, where when I vary the temperature, either I have a superfluid density, phase space density larger than 4, I'll have this algebraic decay of G1, with alpha being 1 over ds. I may have vortex pairs in my system, but no single vortices. Or I am at a temperature such that ds is 0, above the critical temperature. G1 now decays exponentially fast, and free vortices are proliferating in my sample. And there is a universal result, which does not depend on the strength of the interaction, that ds is equal to 4 at the transition point. Or if you prefer, the alpha, which is here, the way the algebraic function decays, decays like 1 over r to the power 1/4. OK? No? Yes, question. Okay, so again, this is a transition which is not a conventional phase transition. It's not within the Landau paradigm of second order or first order phase transition. So I don't know how to answer your question because I'm not a specialist of BKT physics for superconductors, which is a bit involved, but you should not try to map on this system the usual phase transition you are used to, okay? Because this state is disordered, but this one is also disordered. It's just that it is disordered in a gentle way to provide this G1. So I don't know how to answer your question, but just a warning about the picture, mental picture you should use to discuss that, okay? But I'm sorry, I would be afraid to say something wrong about superconductors. It's a long and complicated subject. There are some people actually in the audience who know a lot about that. Other question? So one thing that I did not discuss here is how to relate this ds to d, the total phase space density. I told you by hand I replace rho by ρs, phase space density d by superfluid phase space density ds, and I get this universal result. But I didn't tell you now, coming back to real density. What is the total density I need to put in order to reach this critical point? And this is a non-universal result. This is a result that you can obtain only through numerics. The first one to have done this numerics are Prokofiev and Sisnov. And the result is again a log. Total phase space density depends on the interaction strength. And their numerical result from this classical field analysis is log of 380 divided by g tilde. And this is valid only for relatively small g tilde because this total density has to be, of course, larger than 4 because the superfluid density is only a fraction of the total density. So this result is valid when g tilde is not too large. I think g tilde has to be smaller than 4 or 5. So you still have room to study many systems for that, because I told you that g tilde in typical experiments is between 0.1 and 1. So for all these systems, this result is valid. So now we have completely characterize this transition, and we know where to look to find it. Other question? No? So the first observation of BKT physics was done, as I described in the colloquium, on liquid helium film, so I will not say more about that. It was, I remind you, a helium film adsorbed on a torsion pendulum, and people were looking at the oscillation of this torsion pendulum and showing that there was a sudden reduction of the moment of inertia of the pendulum when they were changing the temperature. So now I would like to look to go to atomic and molecular physics and optical physics, and first tell you about an experiment which has indeed measured the critical point of BKT physics and check that the formula that I was just showing from Prokofiev and Smirnov, this log of 380 divided by J tilde, is valid. So it's an experiment that was done in Cambridge, and the experiment, it was done with a harmonic trap. So I remind you what I said about a harmonic trap yesterday, just before concluding. I considered an ideal gas in a harmonic trap, and I told you that by contrast to the uniform system, in a 2D harmonic potential, I can still have a BEC. I told you also that the critical number of particles I had to put in my harmonic potential was this pi square over 6, kBT over h bar omega to the square. And I also insisted that this was a singular transition in the sense that when I look at the density at the center of the trap in the thermodynamic limit, that is the limit which is obtained when I let the trap spring constant go to zero, and I increase the number of particles to keep a constant density at center, then this corresponds to a diverging density at center, rho of zero is equal to infinity, which is impossible to achieve for a gas with repulsive interaction. So I told you it exists on the paper, but as soon as you have repulsive interaction, you should not hope to see that. So now we know that in harmonic potential, we are not going to see with atoms the BEC I was mentioning, but I may ask, what about seeing BKT transition? And so the question is, how many atoms should I put in a trap at a given temperature in order to reach a superfluid threshold, at least at the center of the trap? In a harmonic potential, the density is not uniform. The density is larger at the center than on the edge. So I'm going to add atoms at a given temperature until the density at the center becomes above the superfluid density criterion, and then I may hope to get the BKT transition occurring at the center of my potential. So this is a finite quantity. By contrast, the density here that I get from the BKT theory is finite, by contrast to the threshold for Bose-Einstein condensation. And when you use the equation of state of an interacting 2D gas, so it's a calculation which is a bit involved, but it's all derived from what I said before, you find that the number of particles you have to put in the trap divided by the number of particles you have to put for the ideal gas BC, this kBT over h bar omega to the square with the pi square over 6, is a function, is, can be written 1 plus a complicated function, again with logs, of this interaction strength, G tilde. So there is a relation between the ideal gas BC and the obtaining the BKT transition at the center of the trap, and the only parameter that enters into this ratio between the two numbers is governed by this G tilde, this interaction strength. And what is quite interesting is that when you let G tilde tends to zero in this formula, so when you take the limit of an ideal gas, you find that all this quantity here tends to zero, so you get NC BKT over NC ideal tends to one, which means that the ideal gas condensation that I was describing yesterday actually can be viewed as a limiting case of a more general situation, which is the BKT transition of an interacting gas. That is, when I take the BKT transition of an interacting gas and I take this gas less and less interacting, I end up with a larger and larger density at the center, and in the limiting case, I recover the ideal gas BEC. So this is a nice connection between this BKT physics, which is the correct one as soon as you have interaction between particles, and this marginal condensation that you get in 2D in a harmonic potential for ideal gas, for an ideal gas. Okay? So this is the experiment that was done in Cambridge in the group of Zoran and Zibabich. they took an atomic gas, prepared it in 2D. It was a gas of potassium atom, potassium 39. And potassium 39 atom is a very nice atom because you have a Feshbach resonance. Emmanuel Bloch in his lectures yesterday mentioned that. Feshbach resonance is a way to change the scattering length between the atoms, so to adjust the interaction strength between the atoms. And I remind you that G tilde, my dimensionless interaction parameter, I don't know whether it's written here, no, it's just the ratio between the 3D scattering length divided by the thickness of the gas. So if you vary the 3D scattering length, you will vary G tilde. So with this experiment, they were able to vary G tilde and see what is the BKT threshold as a function of the interaction strength. So the experiment is done in the following way. They prepare their gas in the trap, and they make a time of flight to see whether or not there is a narrow peak at the center of the time of flight. And the presence of this narrow peak in the momentum distribution is related to a G1, which is decaying very smoothly. I remind you that G1 and the momentum distribution are Fourier transform of each other. So if G1 decays very smoothly, it means that there is a very sharp feature in the momentum distribution. And by contrast, if G1 decays fast, there is no sharp feature in the momentum distribution. So by looking at the momentum distribution by time of flight, you can, by Fourier transform, look at G1 and see whether G1 decays fast or less, very fast or less fast. And so they put a certain number of atoms in their trap. There is, at the beginning, the number of atoms is large. And so the density criterion for BKT physics is reached at the center of the trap. And they see indeed a narrow peak. And if they wait a long time, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, then they lose atoms from their trap. And then the density at the center decays. They pass the BKT criterion. And then at the end, the momentum distribution has no sharp feature. It is very broad. And this means that the number of atoms is not sufficient anymore here to see the BKT, the superfluid at the center of the trap. So from this, they can infer where they cross the BKT point. And here, this is an example of this ratio between the number of atoms to have the BKT threshold at the center divided by this NC ideal that I have introduced as a function of G tilde. So as I told you before, G tilde varies typically between 0.1 and 0.5 or 1. And these are all experimental results, the light blue points. The star here is what you expect for a strictly zero interaction strength. Then you recover NCBKT equal NC ideal. This is what I told you. The ideal gas BC can be viewed as a limiting case. And their points really nicely fall on this prediction that I showed before. So this is a nice experiment because it confirms the statement that the ideal gas BC in a 2D harmonic trap is a singular limit of this BKT transition that we have studied for an interacting system. Okay, so maybe it's a good point to stop here to make a little break. And then, after that, I will continue with some other experiments in AMO physics, superfluidity, and then I hope I have time to say a few words about scale invariance. So thank you for the moment, and we stop for a few minutes and start again. Thank you. If there are any private questions, of course. Okay, so let's continue looking at a possible experimental manifestation of BKT physics. The second topic I would like to discuss is superfluidity of 2D fluids. So there I will be relatively fast in the sense that I described this in the colloquium, so I just want to remind you that indeed we can check that these 2D atomic gases are superfluid. And the way we do that is to go back to definition of another definition of superfluidity. So it's not here the rotating bucket experiment. It's a moving impurity. And we ask ourselves, does this moving impurity hit the sample? The impurity is a focused laser beam. So you can see a picture here of a gas in a harmonic potential and a little hole created by a laser. And you move this little hole using some mirrors which are on piezo actuators to scan the position of the laser inside your atomic cloud, and you move it at a given velocity and you check whether or not there is some energy which is deposited by this motion. And so this is an example of results that we obtained a few years ago in Paris, where here as a function of velocity of this object in millimeter per second, we look at the final temperature here in nanokelvin. So just I tell you just to draw your attention on the fact that here you see error bars on the temperature. The error bar on the order of 1 nanokelvin, so it means that you need to do this experiment to reproduce your sample with a nanokelvin precision. So the temperature here is typically 90 nanokelvin, and you need to reproduce a large number of times your same sample with a nanokelvin precision in order to see this increase of temperature, which is on the level of a few nanokelvin. So it's not an easy experiment, okay? It's one has to work a lot, and I should emphasize the work of this PhD student, Rémi Dibucco, at that time, who had worked a lot to see this effect. But here you see the effect of superfluidity by the fact that for velocities which are here below something like 0.6 or 0.7 millimeter per second, there is no discernible heating, and after that, there is an increase of temperature. So there is a critical velocity which is non-zero, below which the moving object does not induce any heating or any measurable heating in the sample, does not excite phonon modes, and so on. Okay, and so we did this experiment for several values of the parameters, several different atom numbers, different temperature. There is all the result can be plotted as a function of a single parameter, which is mu over kBT. I will explain why a bit later. This is the so-called scale invariance that I want to explain in the last part, but let's accept this for the moment. What I ask you to accept is that the physics of a 2D Bose gas is entirely determined by the ratio of chemical potential divided by temperature. And when we plot this critical velocity as a function of mu over kT, when mu over kT is relatively small, we don't see anything, and when mu over kT is larger, here we see some non-zero critical velocity which correspond to a superfluid regime. The gray part here corresponds to what is expected to be normal from the classical field theory. So we were expecting actually the superfluid transition to be here. We found it to be slightly displaced actually. So at the beginning it was a kind of mystery for us, but we have run new classical field simulation together with the team of Ludwig Matte in Hamburg. This is this paper. And actually, the new prediction of classical field is here. The reason for which there is this slight deviation is due essentially to finite size effect in our sample. So the previous prediction was for an infinite system, and the finite size effect accounts for this displacement. So these results now are in excellent agreement with classical field simulation. This experiment is done for a relatively weakly interacting gas. G tilde is equal to 0.1, so it's the classical field works really well for that. Let me say a word about another type of fluid, which is can also be made 2D, which is an object which is hybrid between the atoms I was just showing and the photons I was discussing yesterday. And these hybrid objects are polariton. Yes, excuse me, questions. So when you go too fast, why do you excite phonon modes? Have you heard about Landau's argument or not? No? So it's not an easy question, and there is no answer in 10 seconds. So I have to tell you what happens in a superfluid. So in a superfluid, the excitation, if I have no vortices, are phonons. And the phonon has a dispersion relation, which is at low momenta, which is linear. So this is like that, and later it changes, bends a little bit. So here I have slope E equals CP, a slope sec, which corresponds to the speed of sound, okay? And so the question is, supposing that I start with my impurity, let's take not a laser beam, but it will be simpler with an impurity of mass M. I take an impurity of mass M with a velocity V, so which has an energy E equal 1/2 of mv square, and a momentum P equal mv. I start, this is the impurity. And I ask myself, can this impurity go to a velocity v prime and create a phonon by conserving both momentum and energy? Okay, so it will have a final energy E prime equal 1/2 of mv prime square, and then I will have a phonon equal, which will have energy C times the momentum of the phonon, so the moment P phonon, and I have to conserve also the momentum, so I want to have MV has to be equal to MV prime plus P phonon. So I ask myself, is it possible to find something where I conserve, so I have E, the initial energy has to be equal to E prime plus E phonon, and P equal P prime, the MV prime, plus P phonon. So it's a simple system, and you have to look whether there is a solution of this system. And you find out that this system has a solution if and only if V is larger than C. There exists a solution. So if V is smaller than the sound of velocity, you have no solution. Your object with mass M and velocity V will move freely. It cannot excite any phonon. But if the velocity of the object is larger than C, then you can find a solution. That is, you can find a phonon such that you conserve both energy and momentum. So in this respect, you find immediately with this Landau criterion that you will have a critical velocity, which will be the speed of sound. Okay? So actually, in our system, our critical velocity was smaller than the speed of sound. It was only 0.3 to 0.6 times the speed of sound. And the reason is that the dominant mechanism is not excitation of phonons, but it is excitation of vortex pairs. And this we could not see in experiment because the vortex pairs were too close to each other, but we could see it very well in the classical field simulation. In the wake of the hole created by the laser, we could see little vortex pairs behind. Okay, but the simplest critical velocity you can think of is the sound velocity because of this argument of energy and momentum conservation. But you have to go through the algebra to show that, but once you have written these two conservation equations, it's easy to show. Oh, superfluidity goes in the argument by saying that the branch that you have is this, saying that these are the only excitation that you have. You have phonon excitation and that's it. Yes, but I mean, this is a T equals zero argument also. So if I have plenty of acoustic phonon modes in a normal fluid, they are populated thermally, and then I have to change the reasoning. So here, I assume I have no phonon present, so no stimulated emission of phonon possible. And so it's a zero temperature argument. And in this sense, as soon as I have a simple phonon branch like this with a single speed of sound, I have this Landau criterion. At non-zero temperature with plenty of acoustic phonon mode, it becomes a bit more messy. Yes, you're right. This is known as Landau's argument. This is a famous physicist. Okay. Any other question? No? So I was speaking about another kind of object, which is also 2D, which is, as I was saying, hybrid between light and matter. And these are so-called polariton. So a polariton is actually an object which is made out of an exciton, which is an electron-hole pair in a semiconductor, and a photon. So you start with a quantum well here. So quantum well is a 2D gas of electrons, so to speak, in which you create some excitons by some laser. So you create some electron-hole pairs. This electron-hole pair can recombine, emit a photon. The photon is emitted in the mode of a cavity. So the cavity is formed by these two mirrors, a Bragg mirror. They are Bragg mirrors, but I mean, you don't need to know how these mirrors are made. So the photons can bounce back and forth, re-excite the exciton, and so on. So you have a coupled object between light, which is a photon between these two mirrors, and the matter, which is the exciton. And this couple, this object, composite object, is called a polariton. These polariton are bosons, and they can condense. Their condensation was seen in this paper in 2006. And they have a very low mass. Their mass is very comparable to the mass of the photon I derived in the first lecture. You get it through the size of the cavity, which is similar to what I was describing. So you get a mass which is also very, very low compared to the mass of a single electron. And it's nice as compared to the atom, and nice as compared to the photon, in the sense that it has a very low mass because it has a photonic part. So it's easy to condense. A small mass means a large double wavelength. Here, the mass is the denominator. So a small mass means a large lambda t, so easy to make degenerate. But it also interacts because the exciton together interacts with each other. So you have both a small mass and a relatively large interaction strength. So you get the best of both worlds, of the atomic world and the photonic world. And so this system can also be shown to be superfluid. And this is a picture which was published a bit less than 10 years ago, where you have a polariton fluid either with a low density, so not superfluid, or a large density, superfluid. And this flow of polariton is flowing against some fixed defects here and here. So here, the flow is like this. And you can see that it's not superfluid because there are many ripples forming in the wake of the obstacle, which correspond to the excitation of the phonons I was explaining on the board there. Whereas here, the density is larger. The scientists here have crossed the superfluid transition, and now the flow occurs without any ripple in the wake of the defect. So this is another example of 2D system which is superfluid, these polaritons. Okay, so the last topic I would like to discuss in this section is quality long range order. Oh, yes, excuse me. Excuse me? This one? Yeah? Yes? So the question is, yes. So the question is, I have here this ratio mu over kT, and how do I tune mu? So mu and t are the two Lagrange parameters. I'm giving you an answer which is basic statistical physics, are the two Lagrange parameters describing two conserved quantity, energy and the number of particles. Okay? So if I take a trap, I put some atoms into it, I have a certain number of atoms, n, and a certain energy put in that. So I have two quantities. And I can vary both the atom number and the energy of my system. And so the chemical potential and temperature are the two parameters I need to describe the assembly. So a short answer to your question is I can, if I have a way to maintain a constant temperature, I will vary the atom number, and this will vary the chemical potential. Okay? So it's related to the definition of what is mu and what is t. And we can indeed vary the atom number. If you think, for example, of the experiment I was describing in Cambridge, the one which was you were waiting for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, and the atom number was decaying. This was a way of keeping the same temperature all the time, but varying the chemical potential because the atom number was varying. Okay. Okay, so I would like to go now. Before that, no other question? Oh, yes, okay. So, yes, I mean, so the question is about recombination time of the exciton. The exciton, indeed, are not objects that are long-lived. They recombine, and there is dissipation. Also, there is another source of dissipation, which are the photons, which leave the cavity. So there is indeed, it's not an isolated system. It's a driven system. You constantly pump the system by a laser to form the exciton, and then they decay, and the photons leave the cavity. So it is a driven system, and indeed, the threshold depends on the ratio of how fast you pump the system and how fast the system decays. So the answer to your question is yes, it depends on the excitation recombination time. Yes, it's a good point. I mean, this is a driven system, so the physics of this system is not exactly the same as the isolated system I was discussing before with atoms, where there I put a certain number of atoms in my trap, and then I'm done. Okay, so quasi-long range order and observation of vortices. So I remind you that we expect for 2D homogeneous superfluid this result, that G1 should decay algebraically above the critical value. So far, all experimental results have been obtained in harmonic trapping in the XY plane. We are still working on it for a uniform system, but most of the experiments have been done with harmonic trapping. And therefore, the system is not uniform. The density varies spatially. And this complicates a lot the analysis because the exponent alpha here depends on the density. So if you have a density profile which is not uniform but which is large at the center of the trap and which decays, it means that your exponent alpha will depend itself on position. And so it's becoming a mess. So I'm going to tell you experiments but which are not so clean for the moment, but this is work to be done, okay? So for the moment, we have only, as you will see, semi-quantitative agreement with the theory. So let me start with an old experiment that we did in Paris in 2006 to it was the first one to study the kind of phase currents we can have in a 2D gas. And I'm describing it because it gives you a flavor of what are the tools we have in atomic physics for addressing questions about coherence, phase currents of systems. So at that time, what we did was to prepare actually two planes of atoms, two independent planes, okay? Psi A, top plane, and Psi B, the bottom plane. This one is described by a classical field Psi A, this one by a classical field Psi B. Okay, they are independent. There is no tunneling between the planes. So they have the same temperature, the same density, but they are independent. There is no correlation of phase between the two planes. At a given time, in order to probe the system, we release the confinement along the vertical direction. So the gas on the top plane will expand like this. The gas in the bottom plane will expand like that. The two clouds will overlap along the vertical direction, and they may interfere. They are both made with the same atoms, rubidium atoms, so I may get some matter wave interference. This is what I've shown here. And indeed, if we shine a laser along, say, the y-axis here, and we look at the density of atoms after the interference has been made, we see something like that. We see interference fringes, and these interference fringes contain information about the fluctuation of the field psi A and psi B. And the idea is, what can we learn about the field psi A and psi B by looking at such an interference fringe system? So the interference signal at a given point R is simply the modulus square of psi A plus the modulus square of psi B plus some interference term, which is psi A psi B star times a function which varies along Z, which is e to the I 2 pi little z over some fringe spacing dz, this plus complex conjugate. This formula here is exactly the same formula as the one Emmanuel was showing yesterday when he was looking at the interference of two of the atoms emerging from two lattice sites. If you remember what he was telling you when you make a time of flight and you see some bright peaks in his optical lattice, this is exactly the same formula as the one I'm showing here, except he had many lattice sites which could be along the vertical direction. Whereas here, I have only two sites, which are plane A and plane B. But this expression here is exactly the same expression as the one Emmanuel had in his lecture. So what we are interested in is in local contrast of the interference here, how bright is the bright fringe, how dark is the dark fringe. So the local contrast is this quantity psi A psi B star. Because there is no fixed phase for A and B, the average value of psi A and psi B is zero, but the question is, what is the variance of this local contrast? So the average values are zero, but what are the variance? So let's take this local contrast here, and let's look at its correlation function. So I look at the average value of the local contrast in R, local contrast in R prime. I do this for every image. I take a lot of images, say 1,000 images, but for each image, I calculate the correlation between the contrast in R and contrast in R prime, and I average over all my images. So what I have to take as an average is the average value of psi A, psi B star in R, psi A star, psi B in R prime. Now, if you remember, I told you that the two planes A and B are independent, okay? So the average over A, the product AB, is simply the average over A times the average over B. There is no correlation between what I have in A and what I have in B. So I end up with psi A of R, psi A star of R prime, average, psi B star of R, psi B of R prime, average again. And this is very nice because this is nothing but the function G1 for the plane A. This is nothing but the function G1 for the plane B. And if I assume that the plane A and the plane B are equivalent, same temperature, same number of atoms, this is nothing but G1 modulus square. So it's a way to measure G1 without any external phase reference by making some, what is called optics, heterodyning of two sources. I'm beating two independent sources with each other, and from that I can infer some phase properties of each source. So, as I said, this experiment was done in a harmonic potential in XY, so it was not, we could not see any nice algebraic decay in this experiment, but still we could see that G1 was varying very rapidly around the transition point, so it was a way, the first time we could see with atoms the BKD transition. And also it allowed this pattern to detect nicely the presence of vortices. We had this type of picture here. And when we, from time to time, not always, but from time to time, we saw this type of picture. And when you see this type of picture, it tells you that a single vortex is just appeared in the system. So probably because the partner had went to the edge and we are close to the transition. Why does a single vortex provide you such a picture? Well, it's relatively easy to understand. Just in a model case, suppose that the bottom plane has a phase which is uniform, theta equals zero. In the upper plane, I have a vortex with a phase winding 2 pi. So the phase, say, zero here, pi over 2 here, pi here, 3 pi over 2, and so on. So when I interfere on the left part here, I interfere phase 0 plus phase 0, so I get some fringes, some set of fringes, like cosine square kz. Here, I interfere 0 and pi, so I get another set of fringe sine square kz. And in the middle, where the vortex is, there is a kind of dislocation appearing. So with this type of pattern, we could see that vortices were appearing in the system, and we could study their proliferation around the transition. So it was the first time, again, where people could see vortices in a 2D system like that. Yes?
In this, basically, we have an analogous to the double slit experiment.
So yes.
Is there a way to also look
at, yes,
what's happening here? Is this a long time signal, or how does it relate? Here you give us a description that it's like a far field approximation.
Okay.
What is the analog done in the?
Okay, so the question is that, this is indeed the analogous of a double slit experiment.
Yes.
And this is indeed a far field result. I have
I'm showing. Wait a long time.
I have to wait a long time, indeed, to have these two initial gases are very expanded. And so the question is, do we learn something by being in the near field? In this particular case, I don't know. I didn't think about it. I don't see really what we would gain in being in the near field, but maybe yes. You can tell me, okay. I would still I would like to draw your attention on the fact that it's a double slit experiment, but it is performed with two sources which have no phase relation with each other. These are two independent sources. So the near field properties may be different from the Talbot effect that you know when you have two slits where you shine by the same current wave, okay? I would be happy to discuss. Okay. So here I would like to show a much more recent experiment done a few years ago in the group of Selim Yochim in Heidelberg, which again aims at measuring this G1 function. And there, they measure simply the momentum distribution of the gas in their trap. It was a gas of molecules. It was they took fermionic lithium-6. They formed molecules, dimers, out of their gas. And they were close to a Feshbach resonance, so the molecules were actually interacting very strongly. So the molecules are bosonic. You take two fermions and you make a boson. And the G tilde here was very large. It was equal to 3. So we are now in the strongly interacting case. They measured the momentum distribution of their gas simply by releasing the atom and measuring how fast the gas expands. And I remind you a result that I already mentioned several times, that the momentum distribution N of P is the Fourier transform of the function G1. This is true both for an ideal and interacting gas. So here they plot, they measure N of P and then Fourier transform to get G1. And here they plot G1 as a function of the distance. And they plot this in a log-log scale, so that if you have an algebraic decay in a log-log scale corresponds to a straight line. So the question is, do you see straight lines in this graph? So in red, you have a relatively large temperature, so you do not expect you are below the BKT threshold, so you do not expect algebraic decay, you expect exponential decay, so you don't expect a straight line. But if you go to the purple here, you expect a straight line because you are now in the superfluid region, so you expect this G1 varying like 1 over r to the power alpha. So do you see a straight line? The answer is yes, at least at relatively short distance. So it's nice. It seems that there is indeed some algebraic decay in this system. The problem is that when you calculate the exponent alpha from that, you don't get at all the exponent that you were expecting from BKT physics, which was 1/4 at most. It was 1/4 right at the transition point, but it was supposed to be smaller than 1/4 if you go deeper in the superfluid regime. Here they find 1.5, which is 6 times too large for the BKT theory. So at the beginning, it was a real mystery, and later on, it was understood by Marcus Holtzman and co-worker that actually there is all this is due to the fact that they are not dealing with a uniform system, they are dealing with a trap system. So part of the gas is superfluid at the center, but there is a part of the gas which is not superfluid on the edge. All these contribute to the N of P, and when you take the Fourier transform, then you get kind of a mess. So you get some algebraic decay, but you get kind of a mess because it's a mixture of effects which are superfluid and effects which are not superfluid. So you get indeed something which looks algebraic, which is algebraic, but the exponent is not at all the one you expect. So there is a crucial role of the thermal non-superfluid wings in the harmonic trap. So the remedy of to that is really to do the same experiment in a harmonic, not in a harmonic potential, but in a uniform system. We are trying to do that in Paris. It's not easy, but this is the only way to hopefully reach one day this exponent 1/4 that remains to be measured with our systems. Okay, so this is what I wanted to describe as a consequence of in AMO physics. And in the last part of this talk, I would like to discuss scale invariance and so-called quantum anomalies. But before that, I can take questions about what has been done experimentally. And I didn't discuss everything that was done experimentally. So if you have any question or comment, I can take it now on the second part. Yes? Yes? So you would like to do it with a simpler system, you mean like an atom in a cavity or something like this. So yes, it's possible. It's not as pure as with the polariton case. But there are some experiments which are done in Zurich, for example, where they have a gas in a cavity and they in the group of Tillmann and Slinger, where they see some phase transition of the system, atoms, which is a two-level system in good approximation, with the photons of the cavity. And they have seen a supersolid transition in a gas, which was 2D also. So it is possible to have two-level system indeed coupled to photons in a cavity. It's not exactly the same formalism as the one of the polariton in a cavity. So in some sense, the polariton are still, you don't guess the very low mass that I was mentioning before for this system of atoms, but it's a two-level system at least. It fulfills one of your requirements. I would need more discussion face-to-face to tell you what are the differences because it's a bit technical, but yes. Let me. Okay, is it possible to?
To eliminate.
You mean in the trap, for example?
In this atom.
Okay, to look at higher moment.
Yes.
Ah. Okay. So assuming that you have an infinite precision, would the other moment contain more information or eliminate? That is an interesting suggestion.
So you can calculate.
Yes. So now that I'm thinking, there have been some work done theoretically by what is called full counting analysis. That is, you measure, as you say, not only the variance, but to try to get the full analysis and try to extract some information of all the moments, which is the idea of this full counting. It has not been implemented experimentally because of lack of good signal-to-noise, but indeed, you're right. There is a possibility for that. There is some information in the other moments. Yes. Actually, this is in condensed matter physics. It's a technique which is indeed quite useful, looking at third moments or something like that. Yes. Good remark. Yes. Okay, so if I don't see any other question, I would like now to go to the scale invariance that I already mentioned, the fact that the relevant parameter is mu over kT and not mu and t separately, and the notion of a quantum anomaly. So I would like to discuss the scale invariance in two ways, and the first way is very basic. It's just looking at dimension analysis in 2D as compared to 3D. When you take a fluid, the thermodynamic properties of the fluid are characterized by some equation of state, and the equation of state, for example, will be expressing the phase space density of the fluid, the product of rho times lambda cube if you are in three dimensions, or rho times lambda square if you are in two dimensions. So d is a dimensionless parameter, both in 3D and in 2D, defined in this way. And this equation of state is, very generally speaking, a function of mu, the chemical potential, a function of T, the temperature, and a function of the interaction strengths. If you look at, in a midfield picture, at the interaction energy per particle, it is, in this midfield picture, proportional to the density of the fluid, so it can always be written by convention. I can always put in front h bar square over m, where a is the mass of a particle, the density of the fluid, rho 3d or rho 2d, time a function g tilde, which characterizes the strength of the interaction. If I am in 3D, then pure dimensional analysis, because rho is measured in atoms per meter cube, this tells me, in order to get an energy here, that g here must have the dimension of a length. And this length is nothing but the scattering length, little a. And since we are doing quantum mechanics, together with the length scale, comes an energy scale And this energy scale is simply h bar square over mx square. So since I'm dealing here with a dimensionless parameter, little d, if I want to express my function f in terms of other dimensionless parameters, then I can express everything in terms of, say, mu divided by this energy scale epsilon and kbt divided by this energy scale epsilon. So I use epsilon as a unit of energy, if you want, in the system. And the most general equation of state in three dimension is of this type. So this means that mu and t, in this case, play independent role. I can, if I change mu by a certain amount and change t by the same amount, I may have a different d because it's what counts is are mu and t separately. If now I'm in 2D, g tilde is dimensionless. I told you before, and within this classical field analysis, g tilde, which is here, is simply the ratio of two lengths, the 3D scattering length divided by the thickness of the gas. Since g tilde is dimensionless, the only way for me to write this phase space entity in 2D as a function of dimensionless quantities is to take the ratio of mu, which is an energy, divided by kT, which is the other energy I have in my problem. I don't have anymore an energy scale related to interactions because interaction is dimensionless, so I have no length scale related to interaction, no energy scale. So the form of an equation of state in 2D is now a function of mu over kT and g tilde. And this means that for a given gas, say a gas of rubidium atom, for a given g tilde, then if I take a given chemical potential mu and a given temperature T, I get a given phase space density. If I multiply mu by 2 and multiply T by 2, I should recover the same phase space density. Okay? This is the scale invariance. And I will explain the scale invariance in various terms in a few minutes. But just at the level of this dimensional analysis, you see that there is a big difference between the 2D case and the 3D case. Here, mu over kT is can only be the relevant parameter, whereas here, mu and t play independent roles. You accept that? Yes? So let's see how we test that, and then I will give you another point of view on the scale invariance. So we are going, again, to use a harmonic potential to test the scale invariance, and the measurement we are going to do relies on the so-called local density approximation, LDA. The idea is to say we have a gas in a harmonic potential like this. It is at a given temperature T. I have put a certain number of atoms in my potential, a certain number N of atoms. And this gas can be described by a chemical potential. This is the question actually that was raised some minutes ago. The chemical potential takes some value. And the local density approximation amounts to say that if I look at the gas not at the center but on the side here, the density that I get at this place is the same density as a gas which would be a uniform box with the same temperature. So the homogeneous temperature in the box is the same as the temperature of the gas. And the chemical potential that I have to put in this box is the chemical potential of the gas at the center minus V of R, the potential, confining potential of the gas. And this approximation, this local density approximation, is valid, assuming that the mean free path of the particle, the Hilling lengths, are very small compared to the size of the gas. The gas, the density has to vary very smoothly with respect to microscopic parameters in order for this local density approximation to be valid. Okay? So let's assume that this LDA local density approximation is valid. And so the experiment that I'm showing here that we did in our lab, but a similar experiment was done in Chicago in the group of Shengxin, is the following. We take a harmonic potential and we put different, we do the experiment with various numbers of atoms, various temperature for the gas. So we get very different profile depending on the temperature. So it's hard to read, but the temperature ranges from 40 nanokelvin to 140. So we vary the temperature a lot by a factor of 4 or 5. We vary the atom number a lot also. And we get very different density profile. We look at the wings of the density profile here to infer the value of the temperature and the chemical potential. There in the wings, the density is very low, so we can use our Artifact approximation to to infer the value of mu and t. And we plot all these profiles in terms of the local chemical potential, according to the local density approximation, mu minus v of r, divided by kt. And here I plot not the density in atom per micrometer square, but the phase space density, which is the density times lambda square, where lambda, again, is this double wavelength here, varying like 1 over square root of t. And the nice thing is that all the points here, all the profiles, which were very different from each other, they all fall on the same curve. And this is a direct verification of this scale invariance. That is, the phase space density d depends only on the ratio mu over t, mu varied by a factor of 4 to even more, t varied by a factor of 4 or 5, but all points fall on the same curve. Question? What is the x-axis here? This is the distance, is your good question. I should have written it. This is the distance to the center in micrometer. So this is really a raw image, okay? I take a picture, and so this is the center of the trap, 20 micrometer, 40 micrometer. So since I know my harmonic potential, I can convert this r into a v of r, and I determine mu from the and t from the wings, and this is how I build that. Thanks for asking. Sorry for forgetting that. So a thermodynamic quantity like phase space density depends only on the ratio mu over kt and not on mu and t separately. This is the scale invariance of the 2D gas. But again, this is not true for a 3D gas, and this is not true for a 1D gas. This is specific of two dimensions. And by the way, the result, the equation of state that we get here, it was in excellent agreement with the equation of state predicted by classical field, again, the Prokofiev and Fitzsimonov result that I mentioned before. Let me give you another way of looking at the scale invariance, and then this will bring me to the notion of the scale of the quantum anomaly. Let's take an interacting gas in any dimension for the moment. So the energy of this interacting gas, this is a gas in a box. So this is the sum of the kinetic energy plus the interaction energy. Kinetic energy is the sum of the Pg squared over 2m. Interaction energy is the sum of V of I minus Rj, where V is interaction potential between two partners. Let's suppose that I make a scaling transformation here, which amounts to keep the number of atoms constant, multiply all the distances by a factor lambda, and divide all the velocities by the same factor lambda. So if you prefer, multiplying by 1 over lambda. The reason for this is that with this, I preserve the phase space volume element, dr dp, by multiplying r by lambda and dividing p by lambda. So if you want, I take the same gas, but in a larger box, and I have reduced all the velocities by the factor lambda. In this transformation, clearly, the kinetic energy is multiplied by 1 over lambda squared, since every pj is multiplied by 1 over lambda. Suppose now that the interaction energy is also multiplied by 1 over lambda squared. OK? I'm not telling you why it is possible, but let's suppose that. Then, clearly, all the thermodynamic properties of the fluid will be preserved in this scaling. If I change mu by 1 over lambda squared, if I change the temperature by 1 over lambda square, then when I write my partition function, the Boltzmann weight will be the exponential of E minus mu n over kT. E is multiplied by 1 over lambda square because both kinetic and interaction energy are multiplied by 1 over lambda square. I assume that I multiply mu by 1 over lambda square here, n is unchanged, and T is multiplied by this 1 over lambda square. So then the Boltzmann weight is the same. The integration over R and P will be unchanged also, thanks to this remark here. So the partition function will be unchanged, which means that if this is true, if the interaction energy is multiplied by that, in the scaling argument, then I get a result which depends only on mu over t. That is, if I multiply mu and t by the same value, I get the same property for my gas. So now the question is, what does it mean to have this scaling for the interaction energy? What are the examples of that? So what I require is to have my interaction potential V such that when I multiply R by lambda, V is multiplied by 1 over lambda square. What are examples of this? So I can have V equal 0. If I V equals 0, of course, this is verified. And this is the case of the ideal gas. The ideal gas is scale invariant. You can go back to statistical physics course, everything in the ideal gas depends only on the ratio mu over T, if I plot, for example, the phase space density. Now, you may think of a fluid of with interaction 1/r². This is our famous model in statistical physics corresponding to that. But another example, which is the one we are interested in this series of lectures, is the contact interaction in 2D. If you take a Dirac distribution in 2D, then this Dirac distribution in 2D has this property, delta 2 of lambda r is 1/λ² delta 2 of r, and therefore, this is what we have, why we have scale invariance in 2D, because of we have described our classical gas by contact interaction. This was the origin of this psi to the 4 interaction energy, and because of that, we have the scale invariance which comes. There is another example which is a bit more subtle, this is what I wrote here, which is a unitary regime, that is a case of an infinite scattering length for a 3D gas of fermions, where here also interactions come without any specific length, and where you have no, well, you recover scale invariance because of this absence of length scale due to interaction, but it's a bit more subtle, so I don't want to go into that. So that's very nice, that's very nice. This scale invariance also comes with some dynamical properties, not only static properties, like the fact that the phase space density depends only on mu over kT, but there are also some dynamical properties which are coming with the scale invariance. This was understood by Pitaleski and Roche in a famous paper, something like 20 years ago. And a simple way to see these dynamical properties due to scale invariance is to look at the breathing mode of a gas in a harmonic potential. Suppose that you have a 2D gas in a harmonic potential, then you can find, you can show that the breathing mode of the gas, that is the contraction and dilatation of the gas like this, occurs always at the same frequency, which is twice the frequency of the trap, 2 omega. And a simple way to show that is to start with a solution of the static GP equation. So I take this psi zero, which is a static solution of the GP equation. And now, what Pitaleski and Roche has shown is that you can build an infinite family of solution of the time-dependent problem by a simple scaling of the rho of the density that you get in your static solution, rho zero. So you get to take rho zero of r divided by a scaling parameter lambda of t. You multiply by 1/λ², so that the integral of rho, the number of atoms, is constant. And so this corresponds to breathing of the gas. And provided your function lambda satisfies this differential equation, then you find that this rho of t will oscillate forever. So you have here an oscillation solution with no damping, although the gas is interacting. So it's something which is not trivial to get this kind of motion. So again, it's specific of the 2D case. It's because in the scaling transform, the interaction energy and the kinetic energy behave in the same way. But unfortunately, life is not that easy, in the sense that this is all based on the use of a Dirac distribution, for describing the interaction between particles. And the problem with the Dirac distribution in 2D, the contact potential, is that it is not valid from a purely quantum point of view. The Dirac distribution, a contact interaction for describing interaction in 2D lead to singularities, and you need to regularize this. If you want to treat the collision between particles in a quantum way, you need to regularize the Dirac distribution. And this regularization introduces a length scale, and this length scale breaks the scale invariance. And this problem is actually very nice because it's an illustration of a well-known phenomenon in quantum field theory, which is called quantum anomaly. To my knowledge, this is the simplest example of what a quantum anomaly is. You take a system which, at the classical level, has an exact symmetry. And for us, the system at the classical level was our classical field approach. This classical field described by the energy g tilde, the integral of psi to the 4, which had a scale invariance. This was the exact symmetry at the classical level. Now you want to quantify the problem. You want to go to the system where quantum effects are non-negligible, and this will be valid, which will be important if you go to very strongly interacting gas, where g tilde is larger than 1, then the classical field approach may not be so valid. So you have to go to the quantum version of the problem. The quantification of the problem requires a regularization to eliminate some divergences. This is the case of our contact interaction. And in the regularized version, the initial symmetry is lost. This, the reason is that here we have to introduce a length scale to regularize the contact interaction. And in this case, we lose the initial symmetry, so we don't have anymore the scale invariance if g tilde is large. So this is an interesting problem in itself. And this is actually a scenario which is very actively studied for strongly interacting 2D gases, looking for the breaking of the scale invariance. So there are two very recent papers which have appeared on the archive this year, where the two groups, so Chris Vail group is in Australia, Selim Yurkim is in Heidelberg, they have taken a strongly interacting 2D gas. So again, this is a molecular gas. It's made out of fermionic atoms close to Feshbach resonance. So the atoms form molecules, and these molecules are interacting very strongly. What they do in these two groups is to excite the breathing mode of this 2D gas, and they look whether this breathing mode oscillates exactly at the frequency of the trap or twice the frequency of the trap as expected for the scale invariance, frequency 2 omega, or whether there is some small deviation with respect to 2 omega, which would be a signature of the breaking of this scale invariance of the classical at the classical level. So this is an example of the experiment that was done in Chris Vail group. So this is a picture of the breathing 2D gas. This is the size of the gas as a function of time. So you see the breathing mode. The gas contracts and expands, contracts and expands. And from this, you have to extract a frequency. And you have to compare this frequency with the classically expected result, which is 2 omega. So at relatively small interaction strengths, delta omega over omega is zero, which means that it's oscillating at the prediction of a scale invariance, so the classical result. But close to the Feshbach resonance, where you expect very strongly interacting system, they see a deviation of a few percent. And this seems to be a breaking of the scale invariance due to the regularization of this contact interaction. So this is still preliminary. To my knowledge, this has not been published yet, so it's probably still in the referee's hand, but I think it's a very interesting result because it's the first hint of this breaking of the scale invariance in the 2D gas. So I am now close to the end. I would like to summarize what we have seen in these two lectures. So we have started by the point that there is no breaking of a continuous symmetry. This is the Mermin-Wagner theorem. This results from the work of Peierls, Mermin, and Wagner. No crystal, no BC in long-range order. Still, a non-conventional phase transition is possible, superfluid transition. The phase transition is actually of infinite order. There is no critical exponent associated to this phase transition. And we have seen, thanks to atomic and molecular and optical systems, we have been able to explore several features of this BKT transition, the superfluid behavior and the critical points. We have visualized vortices. We have seen propagation of sound. And what I have said about the quasi-long-range order is that the quantitative study of this quasi-long-range order with the measure of the exponent characterizing the algebraic decay of G1 still remains a challenge for our field and for other fields also, but we are working on it. And there are many future developments to come. One of them, which has been mentioned by someone in the audience, is the influence of disorder, which is important, and some groups are working on that. Another topic which I have discussed is the physics beyond classical field, looking for quantum anomalies. And something I didn't address, but which is also very interesting, is to look what happens when you cross the phase transition, when you cross the superfluid transition fast. This is the so-called Keeble-Zurek problem. What are the topological defects that can be left when you cross a phase transition fast? So this Keeble-Zurek problem is well understood when you take a typical second-order phase transition. It is much less understood when you cross a topological phase transition of the type of BKT. So there is still a lot of work going on, both on the theoretical side and the experimental side. So this could be the topic of future lectures a few years from now. With this, I will stop, and thank you very much for your attention during these two lectures.